victims were outside a marked and designated ski run when the accident happened. The recent deaths of Michael Kennedy and Representative Sonny Bono may have focused some attention on ski safety, but retailers say that does not mean an increase in use or sales of ski helmets. Stores in Seattle, Yakima, and Spokane, and ski patrols in the Cascades say customers are talking about the deaths, but there's been no surge in helmet sales. Arizona State plays Washington Huskies at the Edison Pavilion. That's men's basketball. The Huskies are 8-2, the Sun Devils 11-4, and the Husky women's basketball team tries to keep its undefeated record intact tonight when the Huskies play Arizona State in Tempe. The time is 9 minutes past 8 o'clock. We've had a few snow showers this morning. It's 33 degrees in Seattle. The forecast is for precipitation to end. It'll be a partly cloudy morning and a mostly sunny afternoon with cool temperatures, some high around 40. Tonight, clear and cold in the upper 20s. Friday, mostly sunny near 40. Looks like Saturday will be sunny too. This is KUOW. I'm Bill Grant.
This is Morning Edition. I'm Bob Edwards. President Clinton goes to New York today. He's on a two-day trip to New York and Texas, during which he will raise funds for the Democratic Party and announce a new initiative on education. Yesterday, the president announced another new plan.
She'd do the same thing she did. So she went and bought them by the dozen, and she would just stash them all over the house.
Oh.
So everywhere she might be, she could just reach for them.
Okay, keep talking amongst yourselves.
Okay. I'll be speaking about this level. This is the level about which I will be speaking mostly, maybe.
You know, some have come back, but never like it was apparently before. And the sanitary market was called the sanitary market because that was the market they didn't allow live animals.
That's good.
The yawn is good? Okay.
Are we set?
Yeah.
Good morning, Jeff. I'm Jackson Schmidt from the Pike Place Market Foundation. I want to thank you for coming. This is part of our series of capturing the memories, the reminiscences.
You think I don't know?
That's right.
I've been hanging around this market longer than you have.
That's true. That's true. And that's what I wanted to talk about, was to see if we could ask you to share some of your memories about your experiences in the market that I know go back for many decades.
This place is as much a part of my childhood and my growing up as was the first front room I can remember in Fremont. My mother used to take me down here to the public market during the Second World War. She didn't have any money, but she somehow managed to feed us all. And she would never allow me to come down here on my own. When I was in junior high school, I would lie to her because I found this place so utterly fascinating. And I would take the bus, the fitting bus, and come down to the public market and march around. The market was pretty scuzzy in those days. And I came to work here in 1953, something like that. I worked here for several years when I was in high school in order to gather money for college. And then I really got into the flavor of this place. It's like no other market in the world. And I've been to just hundreds of markets everywhere. In any case, I started as a washing pans at the Rotary Bakery. And then they graduated me to being donut cook. That's when I'm going to high school. And then one day it happened. The gal who was to decorate cakes didn't come in. So I decorated a cake. And I was just in one of my funky high school moods. And I decorated this cake, Jackson, with purple icing. Dark purple icing. And I put orange trim on it. And then I had the green roses. was so ugly that when I set it down on the elevator, we used to bake on the premises in those days. I set it down on the elevator, and I could hear Mrs. Taylor coming up. She ran the bakery, and I could hear her coming up the elevator. Hi, son, daughter, get my high school kids, what kind of whatever. She came walking into the bakery, just steam was coming out of her gray hair. A very marked scene. And she said, what were you trying to do to me? And I was embarrassed, and I apologized. And I said, Mrs. Taylor, if that cake isn't sold before the day's out, I'll pay retail for it and take it home. Well, with that, she backed off. The elevator went back down the stairs. 10 minutes later, here you're coming again, and I think, God, now what did I do? I need you another one of those ugly cakes! And that was my birth. It was the flavor and the excitement of the market, where you can come and talk with the people who do this stuff. I was then graduated to Brem's Delicatessen. Brem's started, this is an old market store, I bet you don't even know this one. Brem's Delicatessen started in the 20s, and Mr. Brem, a little bitty stall, for all I know he was out in one of those little cement block indentations, you know, that we're using again now.
That's right.
But when I was working here, those things were just empty. The craftspeople helped save us from those empty spots. In any case, this fellow, Brem, had a barrel of pickles and he sold them. And with the profit the next day, he bought another barrel of pickles and a barrel of sauerkraut. And pretty soon he was the pickle and sauerkraut man. And eventually he opened a deli down here in the market, and the symbol was a pickle, a neon pickle, and it said Brem's. This was one of the great institutions of the market. He then opened them all over town, and then they passed on to his son, and his son did really great things. For instance, one day he bought an entire train car load of coffee, and Brem's Delicatessens didn't sell coffee. So he lost them all, and the last deli, the original one, was the soul of a fellow by the name of Ed Rosler, and Ed bought the name. So for years he was called Mr. Brem, and he hired me. He saw me working hard in the Rotary Grocery and then the Rotary Bakery. So he hired me and taught me to clerk. And in those days, well, it's not much different than now. There's always a gag line that goes along with your package of food. That's one of the great things about shopping in the market. And Rosler had the funniest lines. I would just die laughing. One day a lady leaned over the counter and she said, Mr. Brem, are these eggs fresh? And Rosler went, lady, these eggs are so fresh the chickens haven't even missed them yet. And so he would go. One day he claims a customer came in and she wanted a very fancy lunch meat. And when he told her that Polish ham is priced at the quarter pound, man, not the pound, she said, oh, good heavens, that's terrible. And he said, how about this lovely tongue loaf? It's very delicious and it was beautiful stuff. Henry Packing Company made it. It was gorgeous stuff. And she said, tongue? Ugh! She said, I can't stand anything that comes out of an animal's mouth. Give me a dozen eggs. I'll make a devil. And the lines went on and on and on. I fell in love with the old rascal, and he took me under his arm. My father wasn't around much. And so we kind of adopted each other, but he was an old German. So a pat in the back was about the biggest, you know, the greatest amount of affection I could ever find from the guy. We used to do $400 a day in that deli. You know, yeah, now I wouldn't even pay my espresso tax, for goodness sakes. But we did, and Rosler was very tickled that I was there to help, and pretty soon he would take a day off. He hadn't had a day off for years, and I was in charge, 17 years old. I was so proud. That was one of the proudest days of my life, I think. The other time was when my high school English teacher read a paper in which we were to describe something, anything. She said, describe it. this big round of pickled pig feet. Oh, Lord, we had fun. We had great fun. Well, the time came for me to depart, and I came to work, and one of my jobs was to keep the aisles clear. We worked around this island, and we have hardwood floors and fresh sawdust on it all the time because we sold sweet pickles and things like that, and that would just gum up, but the sawdust would prevent it. Now the health department says, yes, we can't do it. Well, we kept the place clean. In any case, I came in to work on the day that I graduated from high school. That would be in 1957, in May. And I came down every day and worked half of my day in the market, and the other half I spent in school. And here was this briefcase sitting in the middle of the aisle. And I thought, yeah, I've never seen this before. And I figured it had to belong to some salesman, so I just picked it up, put it off to the side, got my apron on, started waiting on customers, cottage cheese and pickled herring. We sold 2,000 pounds of dates out of a single pan every holiday season. And I walked around the counter, and this crazy briefcase was in the middle of the aisle again. This went on all day long. I was moving this briefcase. Finally, at the end of the day, I said, Rossler, whose briefcase is this? For crying out loud, I've been moving it all day long. And he said, how the hell should I know? Take it with you tonight. And I said, well, is it from you and Babe, his wife? No. That was it. Yeah, I took that off to college and then to graduate school in theology. I've still got the thing.
Oh, that's wonderful.
Isn't that a kick?
That's wonderful.
That's the only way he could show affection.
Yeah.
When he died, this again was typical of the market. One of the reasons why I feel guilty having an office where I do. My office is down the street at Marketplace North. Kind of a very high-class ghetto, really. A ghetto means that there are walls. And we have gorgeous green walls and brick walls. But it used to be a very low-income housing center. And customers would come into the market and they couldn't afford food. Jackson, they just didn't have it. And they couldn't afford to pay anything more for what they were paying these little ramshackle apartments. And we had a tray of meat ends, salami ends and cheese ends in the case. I don't think anybody even does that anymore. We chuck everything. But we save the meat ends, and we sell them for 2 bits a pound. Now that's a lot of stuff for 2 bits. And there were some people that, well, they were so down and out that they couldn't afford the 2 bits. So I'd save stuff in a sack at the bottom of the refrigerator and I'd pass it over to them. Rosler lay dying. I was a chaplain at the university and I came by to see him with my clerical collar on and the whole business. I must have scared the man half to death. But he was dying of cancer, and we went through all of our old jokes. Oh, they're not having as much fun in the market as we used to have, right? Too soon, old, and too late, schmuck. And we'd go through the whole business, and I gave him a hug, and said, I hope I'll see you again. Well, we both knew that we wouldn't see each other again. And I was pretty broken up. I knew the old man was going to die. So I said goodbye to him, and I turned and left the bedroom. And just as I got to the door, he said, Oliver! I turned around, and he said, come here! And I went back to him, and I said, what is it? And he said, who the hell do you think put all those salami ends out on the counters for you to snitch it for those people that you were giving the food to? Who do you think put all that stuff out there? I didn't think he knew. He was doing it. Yeah, that's market talk from years and years ago.
So you were just his instrument.
Well, because he couldn't do it.
That's right.
He was an old German. They're so unemotional. I don't know why there are more Germans. No, I love them, but the characters that were running around the market in those days were just terribly exciting to me. The old gal that ran the Milwaukee Sausage Company. Figure out where they got her. and spice. She sold tea with concentrate of orange oil in it and some cloves.
Still sells it.
I've got the recipe. Yeah. You know, I figured it out. I sold it in my own deli for years. But she's down in the basement with Pete Dillarendi's market. Everything was in buckets. And, oh, I would go down there on my break and you'd smell the tea from her stall, and then you'd walk into Pete Dillarendi's place. The Italian market that was just as close to the divine institution as I've ever seen. These were the characters. And the dynamite man, there was a guy who would come. You didn't hear about the dynamite?
No, I don't know anything about him.
He would come by about 10 to 5 each night. And he showed a few salamis, of a case. And he would come up to the counter and he would say, "Dynamite!" You'd have to say dynamite. And then he'd wander on, a perfectly harmless gentleman. He may have been one of the great practical jokers of our time. But the first time he came, Ross would grab me and said, "Here he comes, the dynamite man." And he says, "Dynamite, you say dynamite." And I said, "Okay." So the old fellow walked up to me and he said, "Dynamite." And I responded with, "Dynamite." And Ross just started laughing so hard he couldn't control himself. And the pipe. We had a big piece of pipe under the counter. And in those days, he would say to me, "Don't ever go outside the counter without the pipe." Because there were shoplifters that were really, some of them were really vicious. Since the market's been gentrified and everybody's safe and smiling and happy and they're throwing salmon everywhere, you know, it's very different. But I would see Roswick. He would catch a shoplifter. And there was always a cop on duty where the pig is now, where Rachel stands. There was always a policeman. Always. And Rasmus would pick up this pipe. And he would march out, this stocky little German guy. And he would march out from behind the counter with that pipe and he'd put it up on his shoulder. And he'd go up and tap the guy on the shoulder with the pipe and say, "Give me back the honeycomb that you just stole off my counter." "Oh, I didn't take any honeycomb." "Well, let's talk to the officer." Ooh. And he'd come back on and Roswell would come back in and say, "See, never go outside without the pipe." And I only used the pipe once. And I was terrified. I was frightened to death. And I tried to act like Roswell. It was his day off. I was in charge. We only had four clerks in the joint, you know, and they were all women there. I'm gonna send them out to get this guy. So I put it over my shoulder and I marched up to him, tried to tap him on the shoulder. I had the wrong guy. Oh God! those memories were, and Pasqualina Verdi. Pasqualina was called the Queen of the Market. Came from Italy, and at her funeral, I was able to tell this story. Pasqualina and I knew each other for years and years and years, and we would gather at the good old Athenian market for coffee on Saturday mornings. Since I came back and moving back into the market after degrees in theology and philosophy and sociology and all, I realized to fooey what I wanted to do was run a delicatessen, and eventually I started the television shows and then established my office here in the market, where I belong, where I've always belonged, and where we can do shows, and if you forget something, the studio is just down the street, and if we get something, I have a cook that has a bicycle. "I'll get your scallops!" And I can just say to the cameraman, "Just wait a couple minutes, because this is the Pike Place Farmer's Market, and he'll be right back." Well, Pasqualina and I would sit and talk and laugh and talk and laugh. And on the day of his funeral, I told her daughter, Sue Verdi, their daughter-in-law, said, "You know, Pasqualina and I used to sit down and talk on Saturday mornings, great memories of those conversations. We talked about her cousins in Italy and about her husband and about her coming here and about you guys, of course. At least I think that's what we talked about. Her accent was so thick, I was never sure." And Sue said, "That's funny, that's what Mom always said about you." And with that, we buried the Queen of the Market. She once, standing behind her stall one day, and there was a guy who would always come by and sniff stuff and taste it. One day she turned the hose on. Those are classic moments that could only happen in the market. And they're moments that just fill me with joy. Good memories. I was born on a pickle barrel in the back of Grandma's Deli. That is to say, I realized who days it was all bulk food. Why would you come to the market, for goodness sakes? Well, I think in the early 50s, a lot of people had to. During the Second World War, there was something going on down here called technocracy incorporated. And I don't know how it worked, but it was some kind of a system whereby you could...
Think of those trays as it's artificial, it's not real food. And coming to the market, there's an authenticity that is lacking. You can't get elsewhere in your life when you come and you meet the people who are producing the food, and you're getting real food and not the other as well. I never put it together with the privitude aspect.
It occurs to you, I'm sure, because you're here so much of the time. There is the chicken roast.
is the neon.
Yes, the Brem's neon pickle. Yep. I tried to buy the thing from him, and he didn't want to sell it. Now it's a completely different place. So he kind of. Yes, I was going to say I don't mind the change. Yes, I do mind the change. Mm-hmm. I mind the fact that Houston is not running around behind the counter with this funny hat from the 20s that she used to wear. And her old-fashioned apron that we found down in the basement. There was a floor that belonged to Brennan. And they had a lot of old equipment down there. I don't know what's going on that level now. But we used to put the cheese, the red wax covered with cheddar cheese down there, and just let it sit for 6 months. And then haul it up. The substance was sharp. You couldn't keep it in the case. It would just walk out by itself. It was wonderful fun. And argued with Roswell. He couldn't understand why he didn't send it to the other.
When did you come back to the market after studying theology and practice?
I came back. I had a parish in New York and then a parish in Tacoma. And then I went to the university for 6 years as the university chaplain. And then I opened a delicatessen. And Rosler talked to me about that, but he never made it down there. Hmm. And then the next thing you know, he was dying. I closed up the deli and went into full-time television and cookbook writing. That must have been in 82. And I bought an office here in the market.
So
sacred property.
Right. The initiative to save the market, the Friends of the Market, Victor Steinbrook, and you met Elizabeth Tanner, who was a volunteer from back then. What were your impressions of what the market was like sort of before that process was occurring and what's happened since?
Fuzzy, dirty, mysterious, fun, scary. Rossler would never let me go down the Place de Gaulle.
I've heard about that.
Down the stairs. It was an old wino bar, and the gal that ran it, wine was 35 cents a glass, a jigger. Mm-hmm. Not a jigger, a tumbler. And it was really good stuff, you know, like Nuico or Old St. Charles. Things that, you know, work better than Drano, for goodness sake. And the old lady that ran the joint played an accordion when she was in the mood, and that's for entertainment. And the old winos were down there. And Roger said, don't ever go down there. Of course, I didn't want to kill my cook. And people in the world. Now I take my dearest friends, the ones I respect the most, I take them down to Bill Frank, and I see Fetus, you know, in this elegant restaurant. Where did the old-timers go? One of the things that happened to the market was that the old boys, who kind of saw this as their home, were sort of shuttled around. I'm tickled to say that in the remodeling of the market, in bringing it not just up to date, but in restoring, we've done a good job with low-income housing. So a lot of these fellows, but you know, the prize for watching out for the old-timers has got to go to the old man who runs the Athenian Bar and Grill. Mm-hmm. There's still a special bar. You've got to see this place. It's been there forever. 1938, something like that?
Something like that.
There's a special bar where you can go in and buy a glass of beer for 60 cents, but you can't sit down. It's 75, if you sit. The rest of us can't buy beer at that
price.
You've got to be an old man. You get coffee. Still 15 cents at the counter, because he didn't want to shut out the old people, the old timers, the market folks, he called them.
Along that line,
sure. Switch sides. We're getting light out here. You switch chairs.
Okay.
I thought you were going to do that earlier.
Well, it was okay when it was dark out here, but as it changes, this is not
going to turn. I hope I turned this on, did I? You got sound?
I thought I'm getting sound.
It was off.
What I was going to tell you, Jeff, was that I saw...
that's one of the biggest problems in Washington, trying to find the on button. Give me your story again.
One of the struggles that I have in working for the Market Foundation is people say, well, you know, what is this? Why are you raising money for the market? As if, and this is not only just people from out of town or tourists or guests or my family who's visiting, but people who lived in Seattle for years who, they make the mistake of thinking of the Pike Place Market as a business. They see it as a quaint, old-fashioned version of the Northgate Mall. And I explained to them that, no, you know, that's not what it is at all, that it's a community, particularly it's a low-income community, where people who have spent their entire lives here, who make their livings here, and somewhat marginally, but for some reason they won't leave. They stay and do it. And that this market has much more in common with the old medieval village.
Exactly.
Than
the term community is the word we want. I go down the Midway and I miss some of the old timers that used to be behind the stall. And you know what they're doing now? They're kids, young men, who they should be off working for Bill Gates, for heaven's sake, making some money. These people aren't making money. I don't mean, you know, I mean by that, I mean piles of money. No, barely making a living, but the excitement of going to do something that you absolutely love every day beats anything you can get in Redmond. So here are these handsome kids now, they're running a produce stand. Who would have thought? Raza was afraid that when the old men died, the market would die. Quite the reverse. And Vic Steinberg was right when he said that we have an obligation protect the old town. I can't help but read the tiles on the market. You know, one of the restoration projects that we've had here in the market is in the rebuilding it was to sell tiles with your name on it, your personal name, engraved in clay. $35, isn't that what they were? Mm-hmm. Now, explain this to me, please. You know the market well. Pasqualina Verdi stood at one stall selling basil and squirting seeds for years and years and years. I fell in love with the old girl. The family asked me to talk at her funeral. I told them. My wife and my son bought two tiles. One that said the Frugal Gourmet and the other one said Jeff Smith. And when I went to look for those tiles, I got the little map out, number such and such, and I finally thought, my God, who's standing on top of them? Pasqualina Verdi. She died shortly after that, but she thought it was very funny. I thought it was creepy. But it goes back to affection that I've had for so long. The merchants, you can't go into a supermarket and get the kind of action you get down here. When I walk through the market, I want merchants to call out to me. I want to hear from Frank at Frank's Produce. Jeff, I got those quinces! God, what a search! But I got them for you! And I want a hug from the mushroom lady. what's your week if you don't get a hug from the mushroom lady? One of the papers in the East Coast ran that headline. Frugal Gourmet wants hug from mushroom lady. And then it talks about the Pike Place Farmers Market. Calling us, I'm pleased to say, one of the foremost markets in the Western world. And it's true, and we can be proud of that. And proud of old Vic for saying, no. What newspaper guy got this at the public market conference we had in Philadelphia a while back. Everybody's restoring their markets. We're going back to the street market. New York hasn't a chance. They tore down everything. Mm-hmm. So now they meet in Union Square. Everything's out in the open. You just stand in the rain and buy eggs and mushrooms. Philadelphia has one covered. But the other one, of course, is still out on the street, the old Italian market. Los Angeles has a wonderful young guy by the name of Aaron Shapiro, who has organized farmers, and every day the market is in a different community in Los Angeles. It's all in the streets. He goes in and closes off the streets so they set up their stalls, and then he goes around and collects $10 from everybody. It's just wonderful. Every major city, Chicago, everybody's going back to that. And we've never left it. Because Vic had the foresight to say, no, we got to keep it. The plan was, you remember, that this is great property for some office buildings. Throw out all the old people, throw out all the low-income people, shoot all the market peddlers, and put up some office buildings. This guy, he
true. We get people, they call me all the time. They must call you 10 times a month. But they call all the time and want to talk about things in the market and then have me give them a tour. And there was some, you know, San Antonio or somebody, you know, we have wonderful fun down there. To look out on this midway, going back to what, 1907?
Yes.
Been open every day since. Had some tough times. Few strings on the scales, as I said, but, the broom. Remember the broom story? During the Second World War, Safeway stores, which were just becoming a reality at the end of the war, Safeway stores had a broom by the till, a new broom, and they'd ring it up as you went through, unless you caught it. And we had one at the Rotary Grocery. So there was some of that stuff went on. But I'm very confident now that that even when the tourist comes through and doesn't really quite know how to work the market,
certain moral implication to purchasing time, particularly when you're not going to spend it wisely, this time you save on being with your kids or with people you love. If it's just because you want to get back to the office, I wonder. Down here we don't sell time. If anything, it takes you longer to buy fresh food at the public market and cook it. We're solving some of the traffic problems we used to have. That's better, I think, than it used to be. But it does take longer to cook. And it seems to me that that's the joy of the market. You come in here, I know chefs that have nothing on tomorrow's menu. Nothing. Yeah, that's blue. So they walked out of the midway, and it is our job to inspire them. Turn them on. What's absolutely fresh? Because it says on my menu, everything's fresh. Mm-hmm. And where else are you going to do that? You can't have a truck pull up. You've got to come down to the market and pick out the stuff and argue with the guys. Our fish stalls are, I have people come in from the East Coast. They just go crazy to see our fish. Craig Wall, my former chef, left the company about 3 years ago and is working now for John Fultz, the Louisiana chef. Mm-hmm. And Craig is living with his wife and new baby, who looks just like a teddy bear image of Craig. Just, it's uncanny. They're living in Baton Rouge. And the other day, this is the truth in this market talk. I like that phrase, market talk. Craig, who used to plow through this place and knew every vendor, special shoe or a young woman, every vendor by name, on each shop for the show, would you see? Because everybody has to look good on television. Well, this is where we get it. And he called me on the phone and it was almost weeping. I said, Craig, are you all right, Dave? What's the matter? Yeah, he said, you gotta help me. I said, okay. I can't get good fish down here. The heat, the pollution, the fact that there isn't a good fish market anywhere near his place. He goes into town, and unless it's a restaurant supply, the public fish shops are terrible. They could, you just can't take the heat. And he started crying. I was, please, will you ship me a salmon from Sorry? He doesn't have a cure for fish. And I said, sure. And I said, why don't I throw in a couple of crabs for you, too? Well, our dungeon has crab, which is ours, on the West Coast, only ours. And we eat more than here than I eat in San Francisco for many days. So we shipped him some crabs and some salmon. And John Fultz, this great Louisiana chef, got a hold of a couple of crabs, dungeon has crab. And the whole thing blew. He called me up and said, yeah, I have more crabs! Was on a big bench now with our dungeon fish crab. That's the market. Being away from this place, when I have to go to Nashville, for instance, and take for 2 months at a time, all we eat down there are pork, ribs, and chicken, fried chicken. Yeah. I had to have some lamb one night, you know, for a show, and the butcher said, certainly, I have no trouble getting that for you, about 2 weeks. I just want some lamb chops. For sure, we're learning biblical eating. We eat so well down here. Julia, a child, goes through the place every once in a while and always says the same thing. Aren't you lucky? Well, it isn't luck. No. It isn't luck. It's a great deal of concern about community, about freshness, about creativity. About concocting a recipe when the gal's leaning over the counter and saying, how do you cook this? You gotta make up something. Let me see. I used to do that when I was a kid. And I had customers come in and say, I want Jeff to wait on me. I've got a question. And I learned that routine from Roger. Mm-hmm. I'd think of recipes on the spot, and he'd come back and tell me what a genius I was. That's how I got into food, was listening to that guy. He had a book on the counter, and it was called The Encyclopedia of Food. I finally found one of my own copies, published in 1930, perhaps. And Rosler said, don't
business is the oldest, longest continually operating business in the Pike Place market.
I thought Pete Delorenzi's was.
No, Shelley says it's Saul, but we
can. She knows.
Yeah, she would.
She knows. He's so funny. I've known that guy for so long. He was here when I was young, and I'm going to meet 59 next week.
Yeah.
And he's still a kid. I don't know how he eats fish.
I think so. And I think his dad had operated it before
that's
he did.
Right.
Yeah.
That's right.
So I think it's over 70 years now.
Yeah, I'm sure you're right. That's exciting to know. And
yeah.
This old building across from us, the first building that was put up down here. The story was that the merchant wanted to be closer to the buyer. The farmer wanted this to meet the purchaser. And the pictures of the old wagons down here in the street and the horses just
right.
Chewing on their oats, waiting for the lettuce to be sold. Those are wonderful things.
You know, it's interesting. I just made a connection I hadn't before. When you refer to the supermarkets, actually, the merchant wanting to meet the producer, it was kind of a two-way street. As I understand it, the market originally arose, it was people were scared of grocery trusts. They were trusts.
Trusts.
Like a trust, a monopoly.
Oh, a trust, yes.
Yes, and what they were, it was a reaction against, they were afraid, like what had happened with the oil companies, where suddenly they'd all been swallowed up. There was one large oil company, and the prices went skyrocketing. They were afraid that was going to happen with groceries. And so it was a combination. It was some far-sighted people with the city, and then some of the merchants got together and said, here's what we can do to avoid this problem. And the market still exists as something that is in antithesis to the grocery store.
Outside this window is a sign that's been here for a long, long time. Meet the producer. Now that cracks me up. What's in this sausage? Oh, he's getting challenging.
That's right.
He's new in the market. He's only been here a few years. You see, the new guys, wonderful places. Men that used to cut their own meat. Meat shops that have been here forever. I still can't get satisfaction like I can get down at the Crystal Meats or from Don and Joe's. And Don will do anything for you.
That's right.
He was running around whistling and singing the other day. It was New Year's Eve morning. And you should have heard the noise. You're number 253 for your prime rib roast, Jeff. I got it right here. 253? And I'm way up on the list. Restoration of the market has also offered a restoration to the rest of downtown, to the whole area. I won't tell you who this woman was or is, but she's very active in, never mind. We were trying to establish a market in Tacoma, and she wanted it to be like the market in Vancouver. She said, look what Seattle has. You can, in Seattle, you can go from, what's the beautiful women's clothing shop on the hill that started with B that's gone? Well, say
so B Magnin or?
No, B Magnin or John Doyle Bishop.
Yeah.
You can go all the way from John Doyle Bishop, clear down the hill to the public market. I said, wow, I will stop and go to the public market all the way downhill. John Doyle Bishop. She had it all screwed up. It's the market that revitalized this whole area. Look at the housing now.
Yeah.
My God, years ago you could get a room down here for practically nothing. Now look at the building. Oh, and the old armory. I should have missed that. You don't know anything about that. The old armory is on the site of Vic Steinberg Park. And it was an old brick fortress that the National Guard used. And it was dark and dingy, and they were never home. You know, they never used the thing. And they finally leveled it and put it in the park. And with that came all these other
had been coming out to Seattle almost weekly for months, working on a very big case, and he was just spending all of his time doing it. And he said after he'd been here for about 4 months, he went for a run one day from the hotel. He was staying up at the Four Seasons every week, a couple nights. And he said, I ran through this place, and he said it was that Pike Place Market. And no one had told me about it. I missed it. And he said, I suddenly realized I'd been coming to Seattle for 4 months, and there'd been this great thing. He was filled with a sense of loss for having... That's right.
There's no excuse for not knowing about the market. Yep. This place has become so famous. And I used to feel sorry for other cities that tore down their market. Now I'm just proud of Seattle. I give it up for this. Yeah.
this has been, this has just been a pleasure.
Thank you. This room, this place, I'm sure was as dirty years ago as was Plastigal.
Yeah.
The windows were so filthy you couldn't see out of them, and there was nobody caring for this old kind of stuff. And look at the place now. It's beautiful. That's Market.
Mm-hmm. That's Market Foundation money that helped to restore this room.
Good.
Yeah.
Well, I'm a part of that too, Bob.
You sure are.
St. Vincent de